All right. Hello, Sophie here. I'm an illustrator, and since discovering Blender, I've adopted it for all of my work, both 2D and 3D. And so I needed to make sure that I could recreate that textured, painterly look that I love so much. Now, I've seen amazing textured brushes that people have made for grease pencil, and I'll link them in the description box below. But sadly, I learned pretty quickly that my computer can't handle them. So instead, I've been using the pencil brush, just the pencil brush, and over weeks of using it and modifying the settings and playing around with it on different pieces, I now have 4 custom brushes that I am in love with. In this video, I'll be taking you along with me as I use them to recreate this botanical illustration by W.H. Fitch. It's from 1855, so it's in the public domain. Yay! I'll also link that down below. So basically, I'll just be explaining what makes each brush special and how I use them in my pieces. So, you can download my brushes for free on Gumroad. The link will be at the top of the description box. If you've been enjoying these videos and would like to leave a tip, you can also do that there. And as a bonus, if you donate at least $2, you will be able to download the blend file of the piece that I'll be working on in this video. So if you're nosy like me, you can really poke around in it and see what it looks like from the inside. And that would just really help this channel out a lot. So whatever you choose, thank you for being here. But either way, let's say you've clicked the link and downloaded the brushes. I'll quickly show you how you can add them to any project. All you need to do is go into File and click Append. Then look for the file you downloaded. Go into the Brush folder, and all my brushes start with SJ for Sophie Jantek. So you can shift select all of those and click Append. And then if we go into the Brush tool while we're in draw mode, we see that they all have a 0 next to them. And so what you want to do is just click on each of them and then press on the shield icon next to the 2 that says fake user and make sure that that box becomes blue. So step 0, if you will, is adding a paper texture. Like I mentioned, I haven't been able to get textured brushes to work well on my computer. So instead I add in a background image to very easily get some paper texture that will show through my brush strokes. My personal favorite site for copyright-free images is Pixabay. I spent a whole afternoon collecting paper textures there, and for this example, I thought we could use this one. I'll leave a link in the description of where you can download that too, because I cropped it a bit for this example, and I'll also leave a link to the original creator. I'll also include, and this is the last link, I swear, an article that explains in depth how to add background images to your blend file, because I don't want to just repeat everything that the article said. So the brief explanation is, if you go into the compositing workspace, all you have to do is make sure your node setup looks like this. So you can just shift A and search for each of these nodes and plug them in like you see. Then press here and find your image. Then while you're in object mode, select your camera, and in object data properties, check the box that says background images. And then if we expand this, we can add our image. And now it's already in our file, so we don't even need to search for it again. We can just click on it here. And then the last step is to just go into render properties and open up film and check the box that says transparent. Before we get started, a few final notes. So I draw with a tablet and a stylus, and honestly, I'm not sure how well these brushes would work with a mouse, because all of them in some way or another are affected by pen pressure. So just keep that in mind if you are a mouse user. Like, you definitely don't need anything fancy. I have a fancy drawing tablet just because I've been using tablets for years and years and years. But for years and years and years, I used a really cheap one that was affordable for me at the time. So you don't need anything fancy, but I do think you would need a tablet to be able to recreate the effect that I will be getting. Also, as you can see, I've created a layer for each of my steps, and what I like to do is, if you click here, check the box that says Auto Lock Inactive Layers. This is just something I always use. It helps me to avoid accidentally drawing on the wrong layer and not realizing it, which is always the digital artist's fear. Okay, finally, On to the sketch. I'll keep this brief because I don't actually have a brush for this. I just use the pencil brush as is. But yeah, to get started, we just want to make sure vertex paint is selected and that we're using the solid stroke material that's included in every grease pencil stroke object. When I'm done, I turn the opacity of my sketch layer to between 0.2 to 0.3. And it's up to you if you want to include this layer in your final render. It can give a cool, sketchy pencil look. I personally rarely keep it, but play around with it, see if you like it. And here's the final sketch. This took me about 45 minutes. Okay, now we're getting somewhere. Line art. For this piece, I did the line art on two separate layers. One for the flowers themselves and another for everything else. Because the flowers had mainly a pink color and for everything else I could mainly use a greenish, brownish, yellowish color. I do have a whole video on how I do my multicolored line art, so you can check that out if you want to see my line art in more detail. But basically the biggest change I've made to my line art brush is that I set the hue randomization to 1 and it affects the stroke as a whole. And then I use modifiers to tint it and get this beautiful multicolored line art effect. As you can see, I vary my pen pressure a lot while I work, and I really like including a bit of soft hatching as well as the dark outlines. I make sure to do this step while I'm in solid view. And here's the final line art layer. This took me about 1 hour and 30 minutes. Random tip number one. From experience, I found that my pieces look best when I add a medium-high contrast to them. You can do that by going into Render Properties, opening Color Management, and select it in the Look drop-down menu. Feel free to experiment and see if there's one that you really like the look of for your art. Okay, now we're getting to the good stuff, watercolor. I think this may be my favorite brush, just because it does such a good job of faking watercolor. So now I'm drawing in rendered view. As you can see, I increased the jitter of this brush, which makes it pretty unpredictable. It's also pressure sensitive, so the jitter will be more intense the harder you press with the pen pad. Play around with it. I tend to use Ctrl Z a lot at this stage until the strokes feel just right. Like watercolor, I think in layers. I tend to press softly and overlap multiple strokes. I also have only painted darker, so no whites yet. The lightest color at this point is the color of the paper texture. Something else that helps is I'm using the same pink that I use for the flowers, even where it doesn't belong, like on the leaves and the stem. Since this is kind of the main color of the piece, it will help to tie everything together. Don't worry if you see the edges of the stroke overlap one another or if they don't stay inside the line art. They probably won't. We can fix this later if it bothers you, but I also think it just adds to the unpredictable watercolor effect. And here's what we have so far. Line art plus watercolor. It took me about a half hour, but later when I'm doing the next step, you'll see that I go back to this layer and fix it up a bit more. Once I have a better idea of how the piece is turning out. Random tip number two, keep your palette limited. Every time I use a color, either one of Blender's default colors or a default color I tweak a bit, I press this button to save it. As you can see, it now appears at the bottom of the palette. When I need a new color, I see first if I can reuse one of these colors. Because I've built hue variation into each of my brushes, there will still be a lot of subtle differences in the color that really help breathe life into your piece. And you can do this while also keeping your palette limited, which will help give it a traditional feel and is also in general just a helpful thing to do for when you're painting. For this entire piece, I only ended up using 8 different colors, and here they are. Next is what I call pencil crayon. With this brush, I scribble, I add in sketchy lines because that's a look I personally really love. What makes this brush special is that I up the simplify value quite a bit. You can see in edit mode that not many vertices get drawn at all. This is because I add a lot of scribbly sketchy lines and I want to give my computer a chance. Also, for the purposes of this step, we really don't need the brush strokes to be that complex. With this step, I focus on values, adding in the white areas and the really dark areas. I check my values while I'm working on this step, and I have a whole video on how I set that up too, so check that out if you're interested. If there are some areas where the watercolor has gone over the line art and it's really distracting, I like to clean it up with a color that's close to the paper color, rather than trying to erase the watercolor stroke itself. This will just make it imperfect and help to reinforce that traditional effect. Also, the hue randomization of this brush is quite high, which I love because, once again, I'm just crazy about seeing those subtle differences in color. But every now and then I do want a more specific color, so in this case I usually just undo and redraw until I get a color that feels more right. For example, when I was cleaning up the background, I used this pink color, but I would undo and redraw until I got strokes that were more on the yellow end rather than the pink end. So that's a bit not ideal, but it doesn't come up too much for me personally, and I just so appreciate having, once again, the randomization in hue. How often can I talk about that? And here's how the piece is looking so far. So this pencil crayon step took me about an hour and 45 minutes. Random tip number 3. If the strokes start to overlap one another in a way that you don't like or you're starting to find distracting, you can go into edit mode, select them, and then press Ctrl J to join. They will still have their variation in hue, but you won't see the overlap because they'll be considered the same stroke now. I don't use this too much because mostly I do like that overlapping effect, but it's definitely good to have just in case. Okay. So you may be noticing that the image I'm working on and my rendered image are looking very different, and yeah, honestly, I don't have a solution for that. And maybe that's a deal breaker for you, but I've been working in Blender for all of 2021, and I can honestly say that I have not found this to be very much of a hassle. I'm so used to trying to rush through my pieces that it's kind of nice to have to do this step, to pause every few brushstrokes and see how they're looking. It's added a lot more mindfulness to how I work. I'm a lot more intentional about each stroke, and I enjoy that. I work in Blender, both because it's free and I am cheap, but also because I enjoy the process. And if you try this out and you don't enjoy it, or you think it's dumb having to render every few minutes or every minute, then that just means it's not for you at this point in your life, and that's perfectly fine too. I'm just sharing how I've been working and how I really love to work with Blender. So the only thing I do to make this step easier is I go into output properties and I lower the percentage so that it renders as quickly as possible. Okay, heart to heart over. Let's finish this. So I've had other brushes that I've made and used for a bit and then fell out of love with, but I actually made a new brush just for this piece and just for you people watching this video now, because I noticed the illustration had some areas that were quite speckled and other areas that were dirty. So this final brush is kind of a dirt slash spotty brush. So unlike my other brushes, I actually play around with the radius of this one, and I used it to add in those speckles and also those areas of dirt, which I think just really helps it to feel like an old, weathered illustration, and just adds an effect that I personally really like. The only thing to note about this brush is that you need to change the material. So I just used the dot stroke that comes included in the materials, again, when you have a grease pencil stroke object. And here is the final piece. This last step, minus actually modifying and making this new brush, took me about 15 minutes. So thank you for being here. Liking and subscribing would help me out a ton. As usual, you can find me everywhere at Sophie Jantak, and I will see you very soon. Why did I not think about adding that until now? I absolutely want to see if you make something inspired by this video. Please share with me. Okay, talk soon. Bye.